great job. Singers and players, there is no shortage of singers and players in First Baptist Church, whether you like it in English or Spanish. Y'all come and we will take care of that need. I invite you to open your Bibles today back to the book of Deuteronomy. We are in a series of sermons and we're going to continue to stay in that series today. But Deuteronomy chapter number 5, and we'll begin reading in a moment down at verse number 12. Deuteronomy chapter number 5. My family will tell you that I am highly competitive, that I do not like to lose at anything. In fact, if you tell me that there is something I cannot do, I will break my neck trying to do it. Several years ago at Christmas, a couple of my grandsons got for their Christmas presents what is called a hoverboard. You know what a hoverboard is? It's a platform. It's about this long, about this wide, has two wheels on the side, and it swivels back and forth. And depending upon the balance of your body, that's the way you direct the hoverboard. So you can press down and you can go one way, press back, go another way, lean slightly to one side, go in one direction. My grandsons are so good they can just spin around on those things. But they got those hoverboards. They came over to my house for lunch that day, and I was looking at them, and they looked like, man, they were just having a blast on those things, just zipping around the house. And one of my grandsons said, well, Papa, you want to give it a try? And I declined. And then asked me again, and I declined. And then one of them made the mistake of saying, Papa, I don't think you can ride this thing. And so I'm thinking to myself, it can't be that hard. You know, I was always pretty athletic, and even at my age today, I'm still in pretty good shape, so really can't be that hard. But nevertheless, I declined, and I didn't give it a shot. But then my grandsons, they decided they would go outside and play, and the rest of the family joined them outside. So here I am sitting in the living room by myself with one of those hoverboards. And the more that I looked at that thing, the more that my curiosity was peaking, and I was thinking, you know what? It can't be that hard. And so I jumped up on that hoverboard, and when I did, I lost my balance. And it went one way, I went the other way. And I just laid out flat on my backside. It is by the grace of God that I didn't break something and break it real bad. Now, I learned something that day, and I learned that balance is extremely important in life. And as we continue looking at the story today that we're talking about, and that is God's plan for America, God's hope for America is the family, or it's the home. Fix the home, we fix the nation. And we have been looking at a series of sermons out of the Ten Commandments that we've been applying God's Ten Commandments to the home, to try to fix the home, to try to fix the nation. And today what we're going to look at is a sermon that I want to entitle God's Instructions About the Balanced Life. And I believe that here in Deuteronomy chapter 5, God gives us some amazing instructions that if we will listen to these and apply these, that we will be able to live the kind of balanced life that God intends for us to live. Deuteronomy chapter 5, verse 12, the Lord says, observe the Sabbath day to keep it holy, as the Lord your God commanded you. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall do no work, you nor your son nor your daughter, nor your male servant, nor your female servant, nor your ox, nor your donkey, nor any of your cattle, nor stranger who is within your gates, that your male servant and your female servant may rest as well. I don't know what else he could have added. Everything on that day, he said, is to rest. And remember that you were slaves in the land of Egypt. The Lord your God brought you out from there by a mighty hand, by an outstretched arm. Therefore, the Lord your God commandeth you to keep the Sabbath day. And I would remind us that this section of God's Word is just as inspired as John chapter 3, verse 16. And so when God says to keep the Sabbath day, God is serious about us keeping the Sabbath day. Now, usually when we look at the Ten Commandments and we come to this fourth commandment, normally what we do is we take this idea about the Sabbath, we bring it over into our world, and we look at it something from the perspective of, well, I'm going to take the idea of the Sabbath, I'm going to apply it to Sunday, which is the first day of the week, the day that Jesus was raised from the dead. It's the day that we gather for corporate worship, and so we're going to take the principles of the Sabbath day, at seventh day, Saturday, we're going to apply that to us as believers today as it involves corporate worship. But what I want to do this morning is, with the help of God, I want to take that away from that application, and I want us to put ourselves in the sandals of those that originally received this command and talk about what did it mean to them when the Lord told them that you are to keep the Sabbath day. The truth of the matter is, originally, when this commandment was given, it had nothing to do with corporate worship. There was no church. There was no synagogue. There was no temple. There was no place for God's people to come together and to gather for corporate worship. Now, if this commandment did not mean that, then it ought to pique our interest to try to find out, well, what was it then that God was trying to communicate to his people when he told them that they were to keep the Sabbath? You see, this particular commandment, it's much more than just what occurs in our lives on Sunday morning. In fact, it is a commandment that deals with all of life and how God says that we are to balance out all of life. The idea of the Sabbath is mentioned, and that word means rest. So obviously, the commandment is talking something about rest and how that's a part of living this balanced life. So let's kind of get into the text, and I want to just bring out a couple of lessons that we learn from this fourth commandment. And the first lesson that we learn is simply a lesson about labor. A lesson about labor. In verse number 13, God says, 6 days shall you work. Now remember, the Ten Commandments were originally given in Exodus chapter 20. And now Moses is rehearsing those right before God's people go into the promised land. And it was almost like, and remember I said in the beginning that the Ten Commandments were originally given to families, to parents. And it's almost like as God's children are getting ready to go into the promised land, enter a new way of living, that he says to these parents, now, there's something very important I want you to teach your children as they go into the promised land. And that is the value of work, work. There are so many things that I'm grateful to my grandfather for, things that he taught me in life. But I tell you one thing I will be forever indebted to my grandfather for was that he taught me the value of work. And he brought me up in a home environment where I was taught to have a strong work ethic. I had chores to do when I got home every afternoon. I was to feed and water the chickens. I was to pick up the chicken eggs. I was to feed the livestock and take care of them. Those were my chores. And I was held accountable for doing those chores. And I received an allowance for doing those chores. And I really think that one of the most spiritual things that a parent could do for a child is to teach them the importance of work and how God views work. Work is an important subject to God. There are three things about work I want to mention. Number one is that work is the will of God. Work is the will of God. Just as it's the will of God for us to gather on Sunday to worship the Lord. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25, that we are not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together. That's the will of God. It's also the will of God for people to work. And you know, work is not something that was invented by the devil. Work is not something that came after the fall as the result of sin. In fact, work was in the garden before man ever fell. Remember that when God created Adam, God put him in the garden, and what did God tell him to do? He said, till the ground. He said, take care of the garden. I'm putting you in this garden, and you're going to have work to do. The Lord Jesus Christ himself was raised in a working man's home. His father, earthly father, Joseph, was a carpenter, had a carpenter's shop. He worked hard with his hands. And I'll just bet that if we could have seen the Lord Jesus Christ before he went into his preaching ministry, I'll bet Jesus would have had calluses on his hands. Because Jesus, like his earthly father, Jesus was a hard-working man. And God has provided for us in his grace the potential of the enjoyment of material things. And yet God has dignified work as the way that we enjoy those things in life. So God has richly, the Bible says in 1 Timothy 6, given us all things that we might enjoy. But God's plan for us enjoying those things is to work to get them. Did you know that the Bible never endorses laziness nor idleness? As a matter of fact, there are warning after warning after warning in the book of Proverbs about the danger of being lazy, the danger of being idle, the danger of not working. And nowhere in the Bible does the Bible ever endorse taking from those that will work and give to those who refuse to work. As a matter of fact, the Bible says that if a person doesn't work, he has no right to live. Now, how do we get that? 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 10. The Apostle Paul said, if a man won't work, neither shall he eat. So you stop eating for a while and see how long you live. The Bible says if a person won't work, refuses to work, that person should not eat. Now, friend, listen, our church feeds a whole lot of people. We take care of people. We feed hungry people. We clothe people. We take care of people that cannot work. But God has never given the church the responsibility of taking care of people that refuse to work. And did you know that the majority of the welfare laws of our land stand in direct opposition to this fourth commandment that is stated here in the book of Deuteronomy? What does it say today when we have a government that just completely cancels college student loans, college debt, debt that has been incurred by going to school? What does it say when they cancel those loans and then make somebody else pay for it that has not created that debt? What does that say? That says that it's standing in opposition to God's word. God's word says that the individual should work himself or herself to relieve the debt that that individual has incurred. So work is the will of God. But secondly, work is the worship of God. Is the worship of God. I really believe that a huge issue that is facing us today is that in our culture, we have adopted the pagan teachings of the early first century, and we have taken and drawn a line of demarcation between the sacred and between the secular. And so we have compartmentalized these things. We have the sacred over here, and then we have the secular over here. You know, we have sacred things like going to church, reading the Bible, spending time in prayer, listening to sermons, listening to good Christian music, and all of those things we say, now these things are sacred. But then we come along and we say, well, something like work, we're going to put that in the secular compartment. But did you know that God does not do that? God does not draw a line between the sacred and between the secular. In fact, all work is God's work. Can I get a witness? All work, no matter what that job is, all work is God's work. That is exactly what he was teaching in Deuteronomy 5, and that's what Paul was stressing over in the book of Colossians chapter 3, listen to these verses 22 through 24. He says, bondservants, and here he is addressing back during the first century the idea of slaves and slave owners, and we would take that now, we would apply it to employers and employees. But now listen to this verse, bondservants, obey in all things your masters according to the flesh, not with eye service as men pleasers, but in sincerity of heart, fearing God. In other words, don't go to work and do your job just to please your boss. In other words, you go to work and you do it to please your God. You do it in the fear of God. He says in verse number 23, and whatever you do, all things and in whatever you do, do it heartily as to the Lord, not to men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the reward reward of the inheritance, for you serve the Lord Christ. In your job, what are you doing as you work? You are serving the Lord Christ. And you see, dear friends, we get the idea that sometimes, you know, work is secular. What we do at church is spiritual. But all work is spiritual work, because when we're working, we are serving in the will of God. So when I go to work, I go to my job. What am I doing? I am operating within the will of God. And as I am operating in the will of God, I am doing a spiritual work. Only work that is inherently sinful is secular work. You know, I could say that, drug running, or I could say that prostitution, or I could say that bank robbery, or I could say that identity theft, all of that is work. But that would be secular work, because that is inherently sinful. But any other kind of work is considered to be a sacred work, not a secular work. So to describe good, honest, ethical work as being secular is to be totally unbiblical. Friend, we go to work for the same reason we go to church, to worship the Lord God. When you get up in the morning, you go to your job and you go to work, why do you go? You go there to worship God. It's an act of worship. And I really think that over the years, now listen to me, I think we've developed some strange ideas about what it means to fully follow the will of God. You know, the idea that the only way I can fully follow the will of God is to be a preacher or a missionary or to volunteer my life to death in doing work at church, that's the only way I can fully follow the will of God. Friend, that's just not true. I mean, what would have happened, for example, if, say, William Wilberforce, the guy that was single-handedly known for abolishing the British slave trade, what if he would have left his secular job for the purpose of doing sacred work? What was his secular job? It was politics. And it's interesting that when I read the biography of William Wilberforce, it said that when he fully committed his life to Christ and he wanted to fully follow what would be the will of God for his life, he went to his dear friend John Newton, who was the ex-slave trader that wrote that hymn we sing about, Amazing Grace. And he asked him, now that he was fully following Christ, he said, Mr. Newton, do you think that I ought to enroll in seminary? And Mr. Newton wisely said, well, have you ever considered that maybe God has you in Parliament for a purpose? And so Wilberforce stayed in Parliament. And the result of him staying there was that he was able to accomplish so much more in the will of God than he ever would have been able to accomplish standing behind a pulpit. See, dear friends, listen, we don't need more and more people to come out of the marketplace and go into the church to go to work. We need more and more people to come out of the church and go into the marketplace and see their job as being the will of God for their life, and do it for His glory. And so we get mixed up and we get confused sometimes. Friend, work is the worship of God. But work is also the witness of God. It is the witness of God to us. When we are working, going to our job, seeing that is the will of God, it is a witness to us that we're not simply to think about God only one day a week, but we're to think about God in the entirety of our life. You see, nothing for us as followers of Jesus Christ should ever be divided in the sacred and the secular. The Lord God of Sunday is the Lord God of Monday through Thursday and on through Saturday. He's the Lord God of every day. And you see, we have one God, listen, for every day, which means that we have one set of moral values for every day. How many of you were raised in a family that you were taught that on Sunday there are just some things you don't do? You don't do that on Sunday. Let me tell you something. If you don't do it on Sunday, you better not do it on Monday. Every day is the Lord's day. And if we can't do it on Sunday, we ought not do it the rest of the week. And if we can do it on Sunday, we ought to do it the rest of the week as well. So all of life is sacred. All of life. Whether we're washing dishes, digging a ditch, writing a sales contract, competing in a sporting event, doing a math test, all of life, all work in life is sacred before God. And that is one of the great principles, I think, that he was trying to teach through this fourth commandment. And even though we know that work is not worldly, we know that work in the marketplace is often dominated by worldly values. And there is that temptation for us as we go into the workplace for us to be dominated by those worldly values. We can't. We must not. And so when we go into the workforce, the workplace, the marketplace, as followers of Jesus Christ, and we are not dominated by those worldly values that dominate everyone else, guess what happens? That is when our light shines and God uses us to make a difference in the marketplace. I really do believe that we need to reclaim, both in the home and in the church, a biblical theology of work. And we need to understand that, listen, one's work in the marketplace is just as much under God's jurisdiction as the preacher's work in the church. He is just as much God and Lord in the marketplace as he is in the house of worship. And friend, if this is true, and it is, then our daily work is his work. And if it is his work, it should be done in a way that glorifies him. You're talking about taking the drudgery out of getting up and going to work on Monday morning when you begin to see work like this. I'm not going to work to please a boss. I'm going to work to please the Lord my God, and use that as an act of worship. And so we see in this lesson then a lesson about labor. We also see a lesson about leisure. A lesson about leisure. He said, take one day off. Now, I can tell you, when I really began to meditate over this and think about this, I saw something for the first time in my life. And I said, wow. What a truth is being stated here. What a bold testimony this was for the Israelites to keep the Sabbath and to rest one day a week. And what is that bold truth that was being proclaimed? Number one is that it's something that testifies to the world. And what is it that is being testified to the world when God's people then would go into the promised land and they would rest for one day a week? What was being taught? What was being taught was that they could trust in God to take care of them. You see, for the ancient Israelites, listen carefully, to work meant to eat. To eat meant to survive. To take one day away from the work week would put in jeopardy their survival. So the only possible way they could do that was to trust in God. For example, let me give you an illustration. Let's say that here is a little Jewish family They move into the promised land. They get their household together. They put all of those things together, get their house built. Then they go out and they till the fields. Then they plant their crops. And as they plant their crops, they are looking forward to that day when harvest comes, when they are able to get enough grain out of the field, put into the barns, and then that will help them prepare and survive the winter that it's on its way. But let's just suppose that this Jewish family, let's suppose that it's Friday afternoon. It's harvest time. And as they look up into the sky, they see some clouds up there. They say, man, rain is on its way. And they know that their harvest is still out there in the field. They still have not gotten all of it and gotten it out of the field. So they're thinking, you know what, if this rain comes and, man, all the harvest gets wet, we'll not be able to get it in from the field and we'll not be prepared for the winter. And not only that, if the rain puts us off today, we won't be able to go out in the field and get the crops tomorrow. Why? Because that's the Sabbath. The Sabbath is going to start in just a few hours. So what are we to do? We are facing this serious dilemma here. We know what God said about the Sabbath law. We know that He said that we're to rest, that we're not to do any work. But we also know that we have a harvest out there. We got to get out there and we got to get that stuff now. The question is, what would that Jewish family do? Would they do like most of us and work until the job is done? Or would they obey God and trust Him? I really believe that that is why Moses said what he said to this same group of people just a couple of chapters later in Deuteronomy chapter 8. Those first four verses, he said, every commandment which I command you today, you must be careful to observe that you may live and multiply and go in and possess the land of which the Lord swore to your fathers. You shall remember that the Lord your God led you all of the way these 40 years in the wilderness to humble you and to test you, to know what was in your heart, whether you would keep His commandments or not. So He humbled you. He allowed you to hunger, and then He fed you with manna, which you did not know, nor did your fathers know, that He might make you know that man shall not live by bread alone, but lives by every word that proceeds from the mouth of the Lord. Your garments did not wear out on you, nor neither did your foot swell, for all of these 40 years that I took care of you. Now listen carefully. It would have been so easy for them to relapse to the kind of life they lived while they were slaves in Egypt. What kind of life was that while they were slaves in Egypt? 7 days a week they worked. Every single day they went to work, they went to work, they went to work, because their survival depended on it. And now God says to His people, I've got a different way for you to live. You work 6 days, you rest one day. You trust in me that I will take care of you and I will provide for you if you will walk in obedience to what I'm saying about the Sabbath. And so as they did that, nobody else in the promised land did that. And as everybody else saw them taking off work that day and resting, that was a tremendous testimony to the world about their trust in God, because they would obey God. But it was also an amazing reminder to them that both their work and their welfare were in God's hands. And their survival didn't depend on them. Their survival depended upon God. Now, friend, the question that I simply want to ask is this: do we trust God enough to obey the Sabbath principle and to live a balanced life? Do we trust Him enough to do that? You see, that Sabbath, obeying the Sabbath, it testified to the world, but it also protects our well-being. Why should we honor this principle? It protects our well-being. How did God make us? God made us a trichotomy. We are body, we are soul, we are spirit. Obeying the Sabbath principle keeps us well in those three areas of our life: our spirit, our soul, and our body. What is the spirit of man? The spirit of man is that part that communes with God. That's our spirit. God breathed into Adam the breath of life. He became a living spirit. That's the part that communicates with God. But I want to tell you what I've learned about the spirit. The spirit part of man is like a battery, and it'll run down if you don't charge it. And so what we need to do and we must do is we must, listen, take a break. We must get away from the grind of life where we can get alone with God and we can sit still before the Lord and we can reflect and we can meditate upon our relationship with Him. I want to tell you, if all you do, spiritually speaking, is give, and never take in, you're going to wear out spiritually. There's a spirit. It, number one, it replenishes our spirit. Number two, it refreshes our souls. Refreshes our souls. What is the soul of man? The soul of man is the home for the psyche of man, which includes the emotions and the will. That's what's in the soul of man. And dear friend, would anybody disagree with me when I say that we live in such a fast-paced rat race until we are wound up as tight as a violin string? And I'm here to tell you, you may think you're above this, but you're wrong. If we do not obey this Sabbath principle to de-stress, we're going to pop just like a violin string. God set it up like this for us. He knows that we need to rest. We need to refresh our souls. But then we need to rest our bodies. That's the third part of our humanity. Rest our bodies. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31, the Bible says, "But those who wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint." But you got to rest your body. April of 2016, I will never forget. That month, my mentor in the ministry, Brother Wallace Russell, went home to be with the Lord. It's Barbie Flatt's father. And I loved Brother Russell. He was like a second father to me. So much of who I am in the ministry, I owe to him. And so Brother Russell died. And I was invited to participate in that funeral. And I was so happy and so excited to be able to do that. Such an honor for me. But that morning, as Karen and I drove to Dothan, Alabama, for me to participate in that funeral, I was feeling weird that morning, just strange, just kind of squirrely. You know, I didn't tell Karen about it. We just drove on to Dothan. And so I was seated up on the platform, and it was getting my time to stand up and speak. And so I rose to my feet, I opened my Bible to the passage God had put on my heart, Ecclesiastes chapter 3. I looked down at my Bible, and I could not read it. All the words were just so jumbled until I couldn't pick anything off the page. Wiped my eyes, but the problem was not with my eyes. I said, "Well, I know that passage of Scripture by heart." I tried to quote it. I opened my mouth and nothing would come out. I tried to put a few thoughts together and everything was so jumbled, I could not even complete a sentence. Nothing would come out. I said, "Now, wow, this is weird." And so I just looked at the pastor and I said, "I don't know what's going on." I sat down, and then to show you how determined I was, after another speaker got up, I leaned over and said, "Let me try it again." And so I got back up. I went up to the platform, I opened my mouth again, and nothing would come out. Nothing. And so I came off the platform at that time, and there happened to be a registered nurse in that service that day, and he knew something was happening, and so he grabbed me and he said, I've got a blood pressure cuff in my vehicle. I want to check your blood pressure. And he did, and it was like 250 over 140. It was just unreal. I'd never had high blood pressure in my life. And he said, Pastor, you need to get to the hospital right away. And so I told Karen, I said, drive me back to Panama City. I'm not staying in the hospital in Dothan overnight. And so on our way to Panama City, I called my family doctor, and they could tell that my speech was slurring. And so they said, go immediately to the emergency room. So when I got to the emergency room, man, they got me back there, started working on me, running all kind of tests. They thought I was surely having a stroke. And it turned out they labeled it as a TIA, but I don't think anybody ever knew exactly what it was. But when I got released from the hospital, I went the following day to see my medical doctor. And the first thing that my doctor asked me about was my schedule. And so I began to look at it. For 3 months leading up to that funeral, I had tremendously overbooked my speaking schedule. For 3 months, at least two nights a week, sometimes three, and sometimes even four, I had outside speaking engagements plus the regular duties that I do here at church. Because I've always had a hard time saying no. You call me and ask me to preach, if it's to a half a dozen people, I'm going to come and I'm going to preach. And my doctor told me, he said, Craig, what's happened is you have set your body up for a perfect storm. You were exhausted physically, emotionally, mentally, and I would add even spiritually. And he said, you have set yourself up for this. And I did, because I violated the Sabbath principle. I had done it to myself. He said, I want you to take 4 weeks off, do nothing but rest. No preaching. Boy, that was tough. Don't do anything for these 4 weeks. I tell you, it took about 3 weeks for my head to start clearing again. But I remember on that ride from Dothan back to Panama City thinking, I wonder if I'll ever preach again. What a thought that was. All because of my hard-headedness and my stubbornness, and I would not listen to what God clearly taught in this fourth commandment. It was all work, and it was no rest. And God interrupted my frantic flight in April of 2016. God put me on my back to make me see the limitations of my humanness. I just wonder, is somebody else here today, you're violating the Sabbath principle? I think that if God would have sent some of us to do what he sent Jesus to do, we'd have died of exhaustion and not crucifixion. We'd have killed ourselves. Are you living life like that? Friend, it's not worth it. There's a lesson here about leisure. We've got to rest. We've got to take care of the body God's given to us. Think about Jesus. God sent the Lord Jesus into this world to do the most important mission there has ever been. He only had a 3-year window to do it, and he never got in a hurry. Never. He was constantly retiring to the other side of the sea or into the wilderness to rest. If Jesus did that, how much more do we need to do that? I want to close by asking us some questions. I want to ask these questions to you first because I've already asked myself, but I want you to do an honest evaluation. Do you constantly arrive home late at the end of the day with nothing left for your family? physically or emotionally. You've spent it all. There's nothing left to give. Do you have to give as much time to your job as you are giving? Do you have to do that? Or are you just doing that? Are you constantly taking things back that you've delegated to someone else because you know they won't do the job quite like you would do it? So you just do it yourself. Do you think that closing a big deal or completing a task is more important than keeping a promise to a spouse or to a child? Do you? Are you killing yourself living up to someone else's expectations rather than God's? Are you neglecting the Sabbath principle? If so, that's sin. That's sin. Pastor, I would rather burn out than rust out any day. Not me, because you're out either way. Whether you burn out or whether you rust out. You know, if I had the time, which I do not, I would bring up a third lesson we learn from this, and that is a lesson about life, about labor, about leisure, and about life. The lesson we learn about life is come to Jesus. Why is that? Because Jesus is the fulfillment of the Sabbath, according to the book of Hebrews. He is our rest. Come to Jesus. Rest in His finished work on the cross for your salvation. There's nothing you have to do to get it. He's already done it for you. And rest in His promise of His care for you. Jesus said it like this in Matthew 11, verse 28. Come unto me, all ye who are weary and heavy laden, and I'll give you Sabbath. I'll give you rest. Friend, I don't know, but just somehow I am suspicious. Somebody needed what God said today. Now, what are you going to do with it? Would you stand, please? Heads bowed, eyes closed, no one looking around.